wounded heart. Take these tainted hands, wash me in your love. Come like grace again, even when my strength is lost, I'll praise you. Even when I have no song, I'll praise you. Even when it's hard to find the words louder, then I'll sing your praise. I will only sing your praise. Take this mountain weight, take these ocean tears, hold me through the trial.
Play that video if it's queued up.
How would you describe this weekend? And what do you walk away with? Yeah, we'll start this way.
Like,
your questions are like answered.
I like this weekend. I had lots of fun. Had a bunch of new experiences that I've never done, like tubing before. Like that was new. That was awesome for me. I loved it and definitely come back next week.
I've never done snow camp before, and I was like really excited to be calm in the beginning, but like right before we were going, I was like, man, I don't want to do this, it's gonna be cold. And so it's like I prayed and it was like just this whole weight just like left off me.
If I could describe it in one word, I'll say jam-packed, because like every second we had something new to do, something fun, something spiritual, like just something to do.
It's like life changing and then mind changing at the same time, because I definitely like I'm gonna walk out with a different perspective. I really enjoyed the pep rally on Saturday. That one like hit different.
So I guess like this weekend I kind of like built like friendships. I feel like I just learned a lot about myself. It was a time to like reflect.
Me gustó, me gustó mucho todo.
And I like
that.
And I want to come back.
Psalms 139:14. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well.
I wasn't really sure what to expect when coming here. Not gonna lie, I was like terrified. It actually turned out to be really fun. I'm usually like really quiet, but I actually started talking more to people. And yeah, it was just a lot of fun.
It was really humbling, and like everyone here was so embracing. Like from just being at the youth group, like the youth leaders, especially Ashley and Mahogany, like being so embracing when I came here, especially with the play last night, which God really humbled me there.
It was fun. New experiences, new people. That's really it.
When I was sitting down and I was expressing myself to a counselor that I really like we had a really great connection, even though she was like a year older than me. But I never really took it to heart, because I've let all my traumas and past and all that cloud everything that I've ever felt inside of my life. So when she read that, that thing hit me so hard, I couldn't stop crying. I was like, I was just happy.
Amen. So, yeah. So we are actually 1 month away from our next snow camp trip. This is a trip where we take a group of high school students and some middle school students, and a group of leaders also. And it's 7 hours away. It's far away, right? It's up in the mountains, not too far from Vermont. And what happens at these retreats is truly unexplainable. As I'm looking out here and looking there to those who have been there, you have to go to experience what I'm talking about. But here's one way that you can be a part of this. One of the things that we did different this year is we partner up with another youth ministry, and we went halves on a coach bus. Right, that makes us safer on transportation. I'm not driving one of the vans, my little brother's not driving the other van, and I mean, the drive sometimes can be very treacherous when there's snow, so on and so on. So we are currently just raising funds for transportation, amen. We currently have about 29 youth signed up. We're only supposed to sign up 25, and I called the pastor and said, hey, listen, man, I need some more spots. And so we have 29 youth, and we have a whole group of not only youth team leaders, but potential individuals that might catch the vision of snow camp and of youth ministry itself. When it comes down to it, it is the responsibility of this generation, that means you and I, to reach the next generation. And so what will you do to further what God's already doing here? Amen. We are a church that believes in missions, and I believe that this is a mission. Let me say that again. We are a church that support and believe in missions, and I do too. But I really believe that what happens here on Sunday mornings upstairs with Joel and Aralise, what happens downstairs with all those youth, that's missions also. And we need to treat it like that. Amen. And so I think, yeah. So we're currently raising up $1,775. no pressure at all, but if you can, I pray that you would pray to God and see what he would have you sow. No gift is too small. Should I say no gift is too big? But yeah, you know what I mean. Amen? Amen. Can we get right into it this morning?
Amen.
Now, we've been studying the book of 1 Corinthians, and what we find in this book is a lot of stuff. So if you have your Bibles, pull out your Bibles. If you don't worry. I have a few slides that I have set up for you to follow as I read. What we see is Paul answering a lot of questions. A lot of questions. That's right. Any youth at this moment can be dismissed upstairs. I'm sorry about that. He's answering questions on the divisions in the church, answering questions on church roles. I mean, the greatest chapter of love is in this book, right? He's also answering questions about sexual purity, lawsuits, marriage, service instructions, and as we heard last week, the use of tongues and prophecy, right? But I love what Paul is getting ready to do in this chapter, which is remind the church of Corinth what it's all about. And I believe that this morning, we also are to be reminded what this is all about.
Amen.
The key essential priority of our lives, of our ministries, of whatever we are doing. And Paul does an amazing job at bringing everything back. So after this long letter, we see Paul closing out his letter with a clear reminder of what it's all about. And I read, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you have believed in vain, or superficially, or without complete commitment. I want to remind you of the gospel." After such a long letter, Paul is saying, "Church, everything we've talked about, great things, and I'm answering your concerns, and I'm answering whatever's going on within the walls of your church, but listen, I want to remind you of what's important, of what's priority when it comes to our faith, and that is the gospel."
Amen.
I want to remind you of the gospel. You see, he's reminding the church of Corinth about the gospel. There were reports that the resurrection was being denied, meaning life after death. And Paul had much to say about that.
Amen.
Again, he takes them back to why we are where we are today. And that is because of the gospel. Also, false teaching had crept into the walls of this church. And I wonder if we too need to be reminded of the essential and chief priority of our faith, which is the gospel. Maybe you and I aren't in the same boat as the church of Corinth, but I wonder if we also may make the mistake when we place the following things before the gospel. First thing being works. We get so caught up in the doing, and it's not bad doing, it's good. It's all good. But how many know that we can become Martha so well that we lose the art of sitting still at his feet, and we lose the focus, the essential, the key priority of our faith, which is the gospel? How many know that you can become so heavenly minded that you can become of no earthly good?
Amen.
I'll say that one more time. We can become so heavenly minded. Going back to chapter 14 and all these other chapters that Paul speaks about. But then we are of no earthly good with the gospel that has been entrusted to us. What am I saying? Do people run when they see you? That could be a clear indication that we might be in the side of do you hear where I'm going with this? Are you able to engage with someone? Do individuals, whether within the church or outside the church, to be honest, we should be passionate about reaching the lost, right? Because the gospel has not changed, and I'll show you. Do they run from you? Do they want to quickly finish conversations because they're just trying to get away? Do you hear where I'm going with this? You see, we can become so heavenly minded that we become of no earthly good. Is it feelings? Are you placing feelings above the gospel? Can I be honest with everyone in this room? There are times where I feel nothing. I'll say it again. There are times where I feel nothing. But yet, I stay committed. But yet, I pray. But yet, I worship. But yet, and then there are times where I'm about to start crying. Like this morning. I cannot allow feelings to take priority over the gospel. You cannot allow how you're feeling dictate what we've been called to do. I wonder if we too need to be reminded of this. Here's what I'm saying. I can't let those things take priority over the gospel in my life. I know what I've been commissioned to do because it's there. But unfortunately, what ends up happening is we lose focus. We do. We need to be reminded, just as this church of Corinth had to be reminded. We get so wrapped up with our style or method that we lose the essence of our faith. You see, Christ died for our sins, Christ rose, Christ abides in us, and Christ said, go. That's the gospel. Christ died, Christ rose, Christ abides in us, and Christ says, go. That hasn't changed. Is this at the center of your mission statement? Is this at the center of your life? Is this at the center of whatever God has you doing, whether it's within the walls of the church or outside, wherever it is this truth a reality in your life? We get so wrapped up that we lose focus. Let's continue. Verse 3. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. How many know that when it says first importance, it's important? Amen? Amen? I love when I sit down with my team and we're talking about the week and what needs to be done and what priorities. Now, inside, I already know the priority that needs to be done, but I'm listening. And all those things are good, but when it comes down to it, hey, those things are great, but here's the priority that we need to accomplished by the end of the day, right? Here's a priority that needs to be done by midweek, so on and so on. And here Paul is saying, hey, this is of first importance. What is what he's getting ready to say? That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, Peter, and then the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living. Though some have fallen asleep or died, then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born, meaning out of time, meaning after Christ. Why is it that we wait until Easter to remind ourselves or to preach about the resurrection? Did the original disciples and apostles do that? No. They had one message. They had one thing in mind. And that did not change at all. Unfortunately, we changed this. We've made other things priorities rather than the resurrection. They had no other message. Why? Because they experienced it. They had nothing else to say but to speak about what they experienced with him. Christ died. Christ rose. Christ abides. And Christ says, go and make disciples. This is the message the apostles preached and brought with them everywhere they were sent. The essential and chief priority of our faith is the gospel. In Acts, we find that with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection. Witness to what? The what? They gave witness about how to worship and how. No, witness about the resurrection. Witness to what? The resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Why was there great grace upon them all? Because they gave witness about the resurrection. They gave witness about what is priority in our faith. They made that the center of their message. They made that the center of their lives. With great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection, and great grace was upon them all. It would be grace that would be with them as they turned the world upside down. It's not our methodologies. It's not how we do it. It's not our works. It's great grace that's with each and every one of us and has been with us every step of the way. Now, verse 9 says, "For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am." I said, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. I love that attitude. I worked circles around those disciples and apostles. But then watch this. He says, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. God's grace is with us as a result of giving witness to the resurrection of Christ Jesus. As a result, as in placing that first in everything that we do, great grace was with him. By the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach and this is what you believed. You see, Paul is saying, I don't deserve to be called an apostle. I don't deserve to have all that I have. I don't deserve any of this. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. I have accomplished what I have accomplished because of God's grace. You see, God's grace is at work in your life. I stand where I stand because of God's grace. I should have been dead, but God's. I should have been dead, but God. I should have been locked up, but God's grace. I was sick, now am healed because of God's grace. I was addicted, now I'm free because of God's grace. God's grace is with you. It's with us everywhere that we go. By the grace of God, I am what I am. I don't know what you've made it out of, but one thing I know for sure, God's grace. God's grace in your life. God's grace. I almost lost it all, but today I have more because of God's grace. I mean, we can go on and on and on and on, and listen, this is a great avenue. Storytelling. You see, what Paul did is he brought it back to his own story. He's reminding the church of Corinth about, yes, I'm answering all of your questions and hear this, but let me remind you of the chief priority of our faith, and that's the gospel. Then he uses personal testimony, personal story to even drive that point even farther. Great grace is upon all of us to do incredible yet unique things for the glory of God. Each of us, unique, sent out, chosen, picked by name. It's such a beautiful thing. It's great grace upon each and every one of us in this room. As I look back, I can recall the grace of God being with me, not only in the horrible things that I've been through, but also God's favor in the workplace, in the ministry, in many other areas. Allow me to share with you a quick story of God's favor with me. Little did I know that by following a youth pastor named Joshua Kennedy years ago, I would end up going to a pastor's breakfast gathering where they were talking about, hey, we're having a youth event, so on and so on, and we're looking for someone to close out with a story. Well, guess who was there on that morning? Great grace. You see, grace is at work. We fail to identify it at times because we're focused on other things, but God's grace is constantly at work. Boom. The event was great. A couple hundred youth shared my story, but I got to meet a man named Eric Hitchner, who then called me that week and said, hey, listen, you would do great with our middle school kids in this after-school program that I direct. That's code word for, I got these middle school boys that are out of control, and I think you would do great with them, right? I said, hey, I am honored by the call, and I wish I could, but my little baby girl was just born. Things were going well, and I didn't see myself leaving all that. Does that make sense? It just wasn't timing. Well, there was a layoff happening at that company that I was working, and it happened months later, and almost everyone, almost 80% of the company got laid off, and they gave me a heads up, hey, listen, you're being laid off. And so when I heard that, guess what I did? I picked up that phone as fast as I could. Hey, Eric, you still need that middle school. So Jonathan was in the midst of a transition in his life, and he brought me in, and it was great. Yeah, we were reaching a lot of not only church, but also unchurched young individuals that were coming to this after-school program. And it started as once, twice a week, then three, four, five. Then another department in that ministry said, hey, do you have a background in like cleaning and like just doing stuff? I'm like, absolutely, I'll clean whatever you need me to clean right now. What do you need me to do? Watch, God's grace. So they bring me on part-time under that department. So between both departments, it's full-time, we're going for it. And one of my first tasks, watch, great grace. One of my first tasks was painting a wall. Little did they know that Jonathan had probably painted over 1,000 times behind the scene. Meaning, God, years back, God was already working and preparing me to make an impact that day that I was given that one assignment to see where or what kind of value I bring to their team. The young man did a great job. The supervisor, took me into the garage. He's like, hey, here, this is what you need. I painted everything. He went on and on in regards to all that he has done, and I was grateful for it, but I'm listening, and he grabs the drop cloth, and he's grabbing these brushes, grabs a tape, and he walks me over, and I'm thinking, all right, we're going to knock this thing out the park. I can't believe that my first task is painting, but I didn't tell them that I had painting experience. And we get there, and he's like, here's the wall. I see it. I'm like, hey, do you need me to, like, prep anymore? Do you want me to caulk the rest of it? He's like, nope, I already did all that. You just need to paint. I said, okay, not a problem. Then he says, you're going to need this, this, and this, and you're going to need tape. And I'm like, nah, I don't need no tape. I'm okay. He's like, no, you're going to need tape. Like, you got to do a line. I'm like, I don't need tape. I'm okay. Thank you, though. I might use tape at the bottom just in case as I'm rolling, I don't get an oversplash. That's God's grace. Simple. Small. It doesn't have to be a story of tragedy. Amen? Though I have them, and I'm sure we all have stories of pain. But God's grace was with me in the midst of my uncertainty, in the midst of my transition. God said, hey, allow my grace to bless you right now. And what began as a once a week, let's see if you can handle these young men, and they weren't that bad. I mean, they were good kids. They were just, yeah, they were all right. They just needed some direction and a little bit of discipline and someone that wouldn't be scared to talk back to them, right? The other teachers were like, And little did I know that once a week, twice a week, that full-time would now turn into directing multiple departments. That's God's grace. I don't say that to bring any type of acknowledgement to my works. It's God's grace. God's grace is with each and every one of us. And as I look back, I can recall so many stories, and maybe this would make a great topic on Wednesday night. Unfortunately, I won't be able to be here, but Pastor Steve will be leading, of grace stories. What stories of grace do you have? Do you know what happens in a room when stories and when we begin to elevate what God has done in our lives? Do you know what it does in a room? Do you know what it does to the individual that is searching and that is struggling, that is broken? Do you know what that does? God's grace is with us in times of uncertainty. You see, it was grace that was with Abram when God told him to pack up and leave everything. That takes grace, much of it. It was grace that was with Joseph when he was sold into slavery. It was grace that was with David when he was running from Saul. It was grace that was with the disciples as they themselves were being persecuted because they were standing up for a message they believed, which pointed to the resurrection. It wasn't about anything else, and I am not downing anything at all that has been said from this pulpit. Not at all. But I am here to say that if any of those things take priority over the gospel, then we've lost our focus. Christ died, Christ rose, Christ abides in us, and Christ said, go. Are we going? Where are you this morning? Are there any priorities that you have placed above the gospel? And what are they? Identify them. Set them aside. Father, I am so sorry. You know what? Starting today, I choose to go this way. Starting today, I choose to do differently. Starting today, I choose to place the gospel center at the center of all that I do. There is a blessing in that. John Newton was a slave trader. He actually trafficked thousands of women and children into the auction blocks. In 1748, a storm threatened to sink their ship. And whenever there's trouble, what do men do? We pray, absolutely. He fell to his knees and prayed to God for mercy. And it was that night that he sensed that God exists and that he heard his prayer. You see, God will hear even the worst of men. I said, God will hear even the worst of men. That atrocity that happened years ago, that is not okay. That was not okay. But God still heard his cry in his times of misery. He repented and became a preacher and a writer of hymns. In 1772, he wrote a hymn called Faith's Review and Expectation, a song that you and I may know as Amazing, Amazing Grace. One of the most popular songs throughout history, and with only a few notes, has become a song that inspires hope in the wake of tragedy. It lifts the heads of the hopeless and softens the hearts of the hardened. Amazing Grace was sung by both sides of the Civil War, used by Cherokee Indians on the Trail of Tears. Civil rights protesters sung it defiantly during freedom marches. And on the day where I would say the greatest speech, the greatest sermon was ever given, it was also sung there, as Martin Luther King did what God was calling him to do. When Nelson Mandela was brought out of prison, it was Amazing Grace which was sung. When the Berlin Wall came crashing down, it was Grace which was sung. Grace has the power to reform, to right the wrongs, and to turn a man who once traded slaves into one who fought for their freedom. That's grace. That's great grace. The Bible says, my grace is all that you need. What are we placing? What are we doing when it comes to our priorities, when it comes to the gospel? Great grace as a result of individuals bearing witness to the resurrection. What does that have to say for us today? What does that mean for me? Is the resurrection, is the gospel at the center of my home? Is the gospel at the center of all that I am doing? Here's one thing that I've learned when being asked to be a part of certain things. If it doesn't line up with making disciples or pointing individuals of Christ dying, of Christ rising, I don't have no time for it. Does that make sense? If I'm not able to add some value to it by, hey, why don't we do this to point families and young people or whoever it is to discipleship, I don't want nothing to do with it. And we too should be like this with all that we are doing, especially with all the great ministries going on within this house. The gospel has to be at the center of all that we are doing. The grace of God is with me. This morning, I want to encourage you. I want to challenge you to sing with us. And I'm not singing. That's why my mother-in-law is here. You'll see me put the microphone like this when I start raising my voice. And I want you to ponder on God's grace in your life. I can't do that for you. But I know that I experience so much when I start thinking of what God has done for me and what God has done for my family and what God continues to do as we speak. I want you to breathe and to think. Allow God to take you back where he can show you where his grace was at work and active in your life. Can we sing this together? Little did I know that actually at this Ocean City Tabernacle that I speak about, their main worship style is hymns. But I found so much value in that style of worship. And what I want to do is, let's all stand to our feet. And I want to challenge each and every one of you in this room that if you've been touched by the grace of God, that you respond and come to the altar. Not right now, as God pulls on your heart. You'll know exactly when God is telling you to go. God's grace is with you and I. What are you doing about moving those priorities and making the center of all that we do the gospel, the resurrection, that which they did, spoke, and lived out?
Amen. I just have to say something real quick. Everybody knows my feet have been giving me a lot of problems. And this morning they were okay. They weren't great. You know, they were hurting a little bit. And I had two young men pray for me. And so they asked me, well, what's your level of pain? I said, it's a 2. He goes, well, let's pray and make it a 0. Amen. And I'm at a 0. So thank you. Amen. The grace of God. Hallelujah.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see.
'Twas grace.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear, oh, my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, through many dangerous toils and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home.
Praise God.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise my God. Oh, praise God. 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 Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
I said, go. I said, Christ died. Christ rose. Christ abides in us. And he said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to uphold our... This is the gospel that has not changed. A few takeaways. Identify anything taking priority over the gospel in your life. And walk out of these doors today, committing and saying that I will no longer place these above you, Lord. Great grace is upon you to be a witness. Answer the call of God in your life today. I'm sensing that there are individuals in this room that have had just a rough time. I get it. And maybe have lost focus on God's grace being with you. But it is. I want to encourage you this morning to come up for prayer. The altars are open for prayer, anything at all that you may need prayer for. Again, my grace is all you need, he says, and my power works best in weakness. Be blessed. Have a strong, strong week. And may God keep you in all that you are doing. Amen. Amen. Amen, church.